we can analyze the effects of the lesion on the surrounding structures. That is, effect on the teeth, effect on the inferior canal, effect on the maxillary antrum, effect on the surrounding bone density and the trabecular pattern, and to see the effect on the outer cortical bone and the periosteal reaction. Now, can anyone tell me which lesion will cause inferior alveolar nerve or the canal to displace superiorly?
Fibrous.
Yeah, this we have already discussed, that all the other lesions, they are displacing this inferior canal inferiorly. But the only lesion which is displacing it superiorly is the fibrous dysplasia. And the last step is to formulate a radiographic diagnosis. First, we need to know whether the condition is developmental or abnormal. If it is normal, then we need not go into much detail. If it is abnormal, we need to find out whether it is developmental or acquired. Then we have to classify it, and then we have to decide how to proceed further. Now we'll be seeing certain radiographic appearances. I'll be asking you in between if you can tell about it. It will be more interactive session. So the first thing we are seeing here is proximal caries, which is, as you can see. So from this, we have one thing, one question about the, in case of pit and fissure carry, what will be the shape of the caries in enamel, and what will be the shape of caries in dentin, and how they are related to each other?
Inverted cone.
Inverted cone in enamel. Okay. So in enamel, if it is inverted cone, where will be the apex of the cone?
Towards the surface.
Towards the surface. So this is pit and fissure.
Surface. This smooth surface.
Towards the surface. No, we are talking about pit and fissure caries. It will be towards the pit.
Towards the pit.
So this is the cone that is there. Now at the DEJ, it will start spreading in the periphery like this. And from this point again, it will come back. Again, both of them are triangular in shape, but so here we can see the relation between these two triangles is
base to base.
It is base to base. And when if we talk about the smooth surface caries, it will, let's say this is enamel and this is dentin. So how it will start? It will start as a broader region, which will reach the DEJ, again it will spread, and again it will go like this. So here we have the relationship as
apex to base.
Yes, this is apex to base kind of relationship.
Base.
Anyways, let's get back to the appearance. So this is caries, which is easily available. Now, usually in the premolars, we have appearance that is known as cervical burnout. That is phenomenon that occurs as a result of X-ray beam passing through only a thin edge of dentin at the neck of the tooth. Because of this, these areas appear radiolucent to us. So it is very important to check the radiographic appearance with the clinical appearance also, so that we can find out that, okay, there is no caries, but there is just a radiographic appearance that is known as this cervical burn. Then we have appearance known as Mac band effect. Now, the Mac band effect is when there is a sharply defined density difference. When a very radio opaque object, when it is associated with a less radio opaque or radiolucent object, this area of the radiolucent object, which is near to the radio opaque, will appear even more radiolucent to us while seeing in the radio. So this might appear as caries. But remember, this is known as Mac band effect. So this Mac band effect can be close to or in below this, and amalgam restoration also, below amalgam restoration also it can be there, or between enamel and dentin also it can be there, where you can find out presence of a radio lucency, which is known as Mac band effect.
It is really a caries, or it's
no,
just an
effect? It is not a caries, it is just appearance of it. It is known as, okay. That is why we are calling it as Mac band effect. Both okay. The cervical burnout and Mac band effects are differential diagnosis for dental caries based on radiograph. Okay. So we need to find out whether it is caries or not. Someone's audio is on. Please mute your audio so it is not causing any problem. Okay. In between, if you have doubts, you can ask by unmuting yourself. So other findings are, periapical abscess, granuloma, and cyst based on the size. This periapical abscess has hazy radiolucency and irregular margins. A periapical granuloma is smaller in size, with the cyst being larger in size and well-defined margins, corticated margins. Now, these three, the periapical abscess, granuloma, and the periapical cyst, all these three are rarefying reaction. Rarefying means the bone appearing radiolucent. And then we have sclerosing reaction, which is known as condensing osteitis, which is seen attached to the tooth. So whenever there is a low-grade inflammation infection taking place in the pulpal tissue, it will cause irritation in the bone, which will lead to proliferation of the bone tissue, which will create a condensing osteitis. Now, this condensing osteitis can be differentiated from periapical cemental dysplasia based on one feature. You can tell me two features. How will you differentiate between a radio-opaque periapical cemental dysplasia and condensing osteitis?
One is vitality.
Correct. One is vitality. And the second one?
So the cemental dysplasia will be directly from the cementum.
That can be one, but it can again be, you may not be able to tell it properly from cementum, because cementum
PDL space would be intact, visible.
In?
Cemental dysplasia, the minor dura.
Okay, so the PDL space is visible in this condensing osteitis also, where we are. One very important feature which you can see,
sir, involvement.
The soft tissue capsule that will be there for the periapical cemental dysplasia will not be there for the condensing osteitis. So based on that, you can differentiate. Okay?
Sir, can you repeat, please?
The soft tissue capsule or a fibrous capsule. So whenever we are talking about periapical cemental dysplasia, if this is root, and surrounding the root, if this is a periapical cemental dysplasia, you can see a radiolucent lining around it. This is fibrous capsule, which is present for all the, mostly most of the fibrous lesions, but for PCD also it will be present. Now this cemental dysplasia can be of three types. Periapical cemental dysplasia, focal cemental dysplasia, and florid osseous cemental dysplasia. Now, what is the difference between these three? Can anyone tell me?
There are three stages in cemental dysplasia: osteolytic, mixed, and radio opaque. So, according to those stages, we name this.
No, Vishnu, that is actually what you are talking about is stage for any of the cemental dysplasia, either PCD, FOD, or florid osseous dysplasia.
In PCD, the whole length of root is radiolucent. In focal, some part of the
In focal, some teeth are only involved. In florid, all are involved.
Yeah, somewhat. The PCD will be mostly in the anterior tooth, mandibular anteriors. The FOD will be in the posterior teeth. And the florid osseous dysplasia will be in the multiple teeth. Okay? Is it clear, everyone?
Yes, sir.
That is difference between PCD, FOD, and florid osseous dysplasia. So now we have now someone has drawn something on the screen. Please avoid doing so. Now, in this radiograph, what is the finding that you can see, which is, you can see the arrow, no?
On the nutrient canals.
Nutrient canals.
Yes, nutrients canals. And histologically, what we can call this canal?
Hirschfeld canals.
Yes, these are the Hirschfeld canals. Radiographically, they are known as nutrient canals. So, these canals, they carry neurovascular bundles within them. They appear radiolucent. they have uniform thickness, and they are seen in the mandibular periapical radiographs running from the inferior nerve canal towards the root apices. Now, what are we seeing here?
Hypercementosis.
Yes, it is hypercementosis.
First, and you can see IOPA. Hypercementosis.
Both of them are hypercementosis only. Now, can you tell me the second condition, multiple teeth having hypercementosis, is seen
Paget's
in
Paget's disease.
Yes, in Paget's disease it is seen. Can you tell me what other thing you are seeing in this mandible in addition to this multiple hypercementosis?
Cementoblastoma in the third quadrant molar.
No, all of them are hypercementosis. We are seeing osteomyelitis. This radiolucent area we are seeing, no? All of this, and along even in this area also, there is osteomyelitis, which is very common in the Paget's disease. Okay. Now we'll see about the characteristic of the lesion tissue. Lesion means whenever there is a condition within the oral cavity or within the mandible or within the bone, it will have internal structure whenever there is bone loss. So the internal structure of the bone loss can be of three types: the geographic type, moth-eaten type, and permeative type. The geographic type has this large solitary lesion which is more than 10 millimeter in size. The moth-eaten appearance is whenever there is 3 to 10 millimeter sized appearance or lesions with multiple spots. And the permeative type is 1 to 2 millimeter, which will usually you will see in oral cancer. You cannot see a clear lesion, but multiple pinpoint kind of a 1 to 2 millimeter kind of bone loss points are there. So the margins for geographic lesion is well defined, which you can see in a cyst or tumor, right? The moth-eaten appearance, which we see in osteomyelitis, will be there. It is poorly defined, and the permeative type, it is ill defined. The zone of transition is short and well defined here, so you can know where it is ending and where the normal bone is starting. In the moth-eaten, there is a long zone of transition and it is poorly defined. And the permeative type is diffuse and it is non-defined. You cannot tell where it is ending, where it is starting. The cortical remodeling, if this lesion is increasing in size, it will cause thinning of the bone, or the bone might remain normal, just get displaced. In the moth-eaten type, it will cause irregular thinning and even perforation of the bone. And same can be there in the permeative type also. Osteosclerosis may be present surrounding the geographic lesion. Sclerotic means radio-opaque bone present surrounding it, but it will be absent in the other two. The type of lesion, usually these are the benign lesions like cyst and benign tumors, and they'll be non-aggressive. A moth-eaten and permeative type are aggressive to very aggressive kind of lesions. The example, as I told you, the bone and cyst kind of lesion will be in geographic. The moth-eaten is characteristic of osteomyelitis, and the permeative is characteristic of any malignant lesion. Now, this is a geographic pattern, as you can see. A large lesion increased in size. So, it is described as large area of lysis, which implies absence of any kind of expansion as such. And it is not associated with specific type of margins. And it may indicate a monolocular or non-septate benign lesion or a malignant disorder. So, here you can see this lesions, a unilocular ameloblastoma. Can anyone tell me what is this condition here? Your diagnosis?
Sir, residual cyst.
Yes, residual cyst. So we can see a tooth has been extracted from this particular point, but the lesion which was there within this tissue has remained. So it is a residual cyst. So even that is an example of our geographic kind of bone loss. And here, this early stage of a lesion of ossifying fibroma also in the early stage will be lucent. So that is also a geographic pattern. So this geographic pattern can be seen in malignant lesions also, as we can see now. This appearance, can you tell me what is, where do you see this appearance? Multiple
punch cut
multiple myeloma.
Multiple myeloma.
Yeah, in multiple myeloma we'll see. Any other lesion where you can see a punched out lytic lesions of the skull?
Metastatic carcinomas.
Punched out specifically we are talking about.
Thalassemia. Hair on end appearance.
Thalassemia is hair on end appearance. Remember, we had discussed about histiocytosis X, three types.
Langerhans.
LCH is there. Then we have Ewing sarcoma and later CV disease was there. Okay. So in this Langerhans cell histiocytosis or eosinophilic granuloma, both of them can cause punched out lesions. Okay. So these are also example of geographic pattern. Then there is moth eaten appearance seen in the osteomyelitis, which consists of several small area of lysis, which will imply absence of expansion. It will indicate a more aggressive and rapid process than a geographic pattern, and it is seen in association with benign or any malignant conditions also. So this appearance you are seeing here at this particular point, you can zoom your screen also to see this particular point where I marked out. This appearance is known as moth eaten appearance, and this again here, this is osteoradial necrosis, where you can see sequestration, which is seen in more advanced cases. Now, what is a sequestra?
Dead bone.
If there is osteomyelitis or osteonecrosis, a dead bone which is there, it is known as?
Sequestra. Surrounded by the normal bone.
Sequestra. But surrounding the sequestra is, as compared to bone, this is sequestra and this is bone. What will be the difference in the radio opacity? Which will be more radio opaque, sequestrum or bone?
Sequestrum.
Sequestrum will be more radio opaque. What will be the reason?
Dead bone attracts more calcium.
That is known as?
Dystrophic
calcification. Yes, because of dystrophic calcification, this sequestrum, it appears more radio opaque. Now, surrounding this sequestrum, there is a radiolucent lining, which is known as
involucrum.
Yes, it is involucrum. But if this is this necrotic bone that is there, no, in between sequestrum, it will have some abscess or any pus being formed, any this exudative process going on. So it needs to send it out. So it has this lining going out like this. This is known as close. Okay, maybe I am pronouncing it differently, but the spelling is CLOACE. So the dead bone which is there is sequestrum. This is sequestrum. Surrounding the sequestrum, the radiolucent lining, which is involucrum, and the tract which are allowing the pus or the discharge to pass through the sequestrum outside are known as closa. So this difference is clear to everyone. Sequestrum is more radio opaque than the normal bone. Reason is the dystrophic calcification. It is surrounded by the involucrum. This involucrum is a, what is involucrum actually? Can anyone tell me?
New bone.
It
is a necrotic bone between the healthy bone and sequestrum.
The sequestrum itself is a necrotic bone.
It's the viable bone.
It is actually a kind of granulation tissue which is preventing the sequestrum from growing in the surrounding tissue. Okay?
Okay.
And then surrounding part is the normal. So this thing is clear to everyone. Sequestrum, the surrounding involucrum, and the closa. Is the difference clear?
Yes, sir.
Next, we'll be seeing the moth eaten appearance, which is characteristic of a malignancy. Now, this lesion we are seeing here, this actually, of course, no one can tell directly, but this is a lesion of intraosseous squamous cell carcinoma, the one which originates from within the bone. So here this appearance is a moth eaten appearance, and we have a permeative pattern which is also seen in malignancies. You can see this area. This is a carcinoma arising from a dentigerous cyst. This again is a malignancy in the bone which we can find out. Now, talking about the pattern of bone destruction. This all we have seen are kind of unilocular. In unilocular also we see saw three types: the geographic, the which were the three types we saw? Geographic. Second one was
moth eater,
and third one was
permeative.
These were the three types. Now we'll see about the multilocular type of bone destruction, which is usually seen with the locally aggressive condition. So it will rule out malignancy, except for any low-grade malignancy, for example, mucoepidermoid carcinoma, which might appear multilocular. Everyone, you can keep your audio mute. Whenever you have doubt, you can unmute it and you can ask. Or when I'm asking some question, when you want to answer, you can again unmute it. So now we have this multilocular appearance, which will imply that it is locally aggressive, but most of the cases it is not malignant. It will imply that it is causing cortical expansion. It will imply that it is having internal septation, but it has exception of a scallop type. Okay, that what happens is the multilocular, we can see that that means there is multiple septae present within the bone. That is why it is appearing as multilocular. But sometime what happens, let's say this is bone and the lesion is causing scalloping like this. And because of this scalloping, sometimes when we are seeing radiograph from this point, this particular areas might appear as septae in the lesion of the radiograph. So we might think this is a multilocular lesion, but this are due to the septa that are here. So that we should know that based on this, the diagnosis should not get affected. So this multilocular pattern, if they are smaller in size, we'll call them honeycomb pattern. If it is larger in size, we'll call them soap bubble pattern. There are some other pattern also, which is a tennis racket appearance where the septa are at 90 degree to each other, and the scallop pattern that I've just now explained to you. So this you can see a small areas, which is honeycomb pattern, as you can see in this case also. So this is seen in the ameloblastoma and central hemangioma of the bone. This is the soap bubble pattern appearance, which can be again be ameloblastoma, aneurysmal bone cyst, or it can be seen in cherubism, hemangioma, giant cell lesion of hypothyroidism, central giant cell granuloma, OKC. Now let's see, there is a child who came to you with somewhere around 3 or 4 months. There is a bilateral swelling present on the face, and when you took the radiograph in the mandible, on both the ramus you found out soap bubble appearance on the ramus. So what should be your first diagnosis in this case?
Cherubism.
Remember, this is cherubism and it doesn't require any treatment. Otherwise, sometimes what will happen if a person, let's say most of the dental faculty or dental people, they know about cherubism, but some of the medical persons, they might know about this. I am not saying they will not know, but some of them, they might not, they might get confused, and then they'll do biopsy. If you do biopsy of a cherubism, histopathologically, it will show some giant cell lesion only. It will be similar to some giant cell lesion. And then in that case, there have been some cases where for a small child, they removed whole of the mandible thinking the whole mandible is having giant cell tumor. Okay, so this you should remember, that soap bubble appearance is appearance of cherubism also. Then we also have spider pattern, which is exclusively seen in the ameloblastoma. As you can see, this multiple septae like spider. Okay, and then we have tennis racket appearance, which is seen mostly in the myxoma or sometimes in the central hemangioma, where the septae are there at 90 degree, as you can see here also. And then there is scallop pattern. Now remember, OKC as such is not a multilocular cyst. It is a unilocular only. But as I had told you, if it is causing indentation on the bone due to the scalloping, this scallop part, which might appear as radio opaque in these parts, which is causing actually scalloping of the bone. And that's why it is appearing as radio opaque lines of the septa are appearing here. And so we might confuse it as multilocular appearance, but these are basically septa only. So this thing is clear, everyone, that how this scallop pattern is not actually multilocular. Is it clear to everyone? Yes. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Next, sir. We'll see about the pericoronal radiolucencies. Now, when we talk about the dentigerous cyst has three types based on the presence of cyst. The one that we have is, this is the, can you tell me the name of these three? This is central type.
Central and circumferential.
This is a circumferential type of the radiolucency. So pericardial radiolucency usually we'll see with dentigerous cyst, KCOT, AOT, ameloblastic fibroma, and ameloblastoma. Now this radiograph which we are seeing here, let's say this is dentigerous cyst only. So what type of dentigerous cyst it is here?
Circumferential.
You can zoom on the image and you can lateral. See. So it is arising from CEG on both the sides and it is like this. So it is somewhat lateral. Like this part we have seen, no? So this is a lateral type of dentigerous cyst. Now talking about the mineralization of the tumor matrix, the tumor which is radio-opaque. So it can be of different appearances. This we are seeing is cotton wool appearance. The cotton wool appearance can be there in the Paget's disease. It can be seen in diffuse sclerosing osteomyelitis. It can be seen in the florid osseous dysplasia, or it can be seen in the sclerotic cemental masses as well. Here is the Pinburg's tumor. The appearance of Pinburg's tumor is known as snow-driven appearance, as you can see here. Okay, this is for CEOT. This is the ground glass appearance. Now this which we are seeing is a ground glass. You must have seen this kind of glass, which is not not transparent. It is like this. So same appearance we are seeing in the fibrous dysplasia also, and same can be seen in the hyperthyroidism also. Now there have been some question asked about ground glass appearances seen in whether in hyperthyroidism or whether in fibrous dysplasia. Now what to choose answer? Based on this we know it can be seen in both of them, but if you have to choose one, you can choose hyperparathyroidism as answer in this kind of questions, because ground glass has multiple other appearances also. Then this Gorlin flex, where do we see this appearance?
Gorlin cyst.
That is?
COC.
That is our calcifying odontogenic cyst. Okay. Now this impacted canine associated with surrounding radiolucency and radio-opaque flex. That is a diagnostic AOT. Of AOT.
AOT.
Okay. So these are the AOT flex which we are seeing here. This was about the tumor mineralization. Next we'll see about the internal margins. Now we either have a wide zone of transition or we have a narrow zone of transition. Narrow zone of transition means if the lesion is ending here, then within either from where the bone is ending or from where the lesion is ending or within the small area, we can see a normal bone present. So this is a narrow zone of transition. Whereas in the wide zone of transition, you cannot tell where the actual lesion or the margin of the bone or the lesion is ending and where is the normal bone starting. That is wide zone. So for narrow zone of transition, we can have a thick condensed sclerotic border. The sclerotic border can be there, or we can have diffuse sclerotic border. But again, it is a well-defined part. We can have thin condensed sclerotic border. So it can either be thick or it can be thin. Or it can be just a punched out lesion with no sclerotic margin, but a radiolucency and then surrounding bone is there. That can be easily seen. So this you can see a thick sclerotic condensed lesion here. Same way you can see a thick lesion surrounding the tooth. So can you tell me the diagnosis for this condition? This here. Most likely based on the finding we are seeing in the radiograph.
Periapical cyst.
This periapical cyst, because it is more in size. The size is less. If size was less, you could tell periapical granuloma. So this you can see loss of the lamina dura is there. Lamina dura is not visible. And we can see most likely there is a deep restoration which might be touching the pulpal area, which has caused inflammation or infection leading to the periapical cyst. So this is thick sclerotic margin. Then we can have thick diffuse sclerotic margin. This is condensed sclerotic margin where you can see condensed sclerosis, or we can have a diffuse sclerosis. So this actually I was talking about PCD, though. This lucency everyone can see surrounding the lesion. This is the soft tissue capsule I was talking about. And surrounding the soft tissue capsule or the fibrous capsule, there is sclerotic margin. OK, Okay, so this thick diffuse sclerotic margin is seen in the reactive process. For example, cementoma. This is cementoma. It is also seen in periapical cemental dysplasia also. Then we have thin and condensed sclerotic margin, as you can see here also, or surrounding this lesion also there is condensed margin. So it is seen in aggressive stage of odontogenic myxoma, or sometimes we have a punched out lesion, as we had seen in this previous radiograph. Let me show to you here. So here there is no zone of transition. This lesion is ending here and surrounding is the normal bone. So these are the types of narrow zone of transition. Then we have a wide zone of transition where you cannot tell where the normal bone is and starting from the lesion. So this is usually seen in the eosinophilic granuloma, CGCG and aneurysmal bone cyst. The supportive structures of the teeth, what are the things we see in the PDL? So first of all, can anyone tell me what is the normal shape of PDL?
Hourglass appearance.
Yes, this hourglass appearance is there. Okay, so this is the appearance, and where you will see widening of it, it can either be a normal condition, like whenever there is ongoing orthodontic treatment is there, whenever there is scleroderma. Now, in the scleroderma, when we had discussed about oral medicine, we had talked about another appearance associated in the OPG, which you can find out in scleroderma. Can you tell me what you will see?
Thickened lamina dura, generalized thickening of lamina dura.
So, generalized widening of PDL space is there. The second is about something related to mandible, if you remember. Resorption in the ramus or angle region.
Muscle attachments at the region of muscle attachment.
You will see resorption also. There is another finding not associated with the PDL as such. Then in the case of severe bruxism or traumatic injury also, you will see widening of the PDL. Now you can see floating tooth appearance. Now actually in the exam, this one image was asked, and then you were given that what is the appearance name? Floating tooth appearance, flipper tooth appearance, and some four option was there. This appearance is known as floating tooth appearance, which can be seen in cherubism, advanced periodontitis, papillon Lefevre syndrome, squamous cell carcinoma of the gingiva, and histiocytosis X. This histiocytosis we have discussed previously. Now, can you tell me what we will see in this papillon Lefevre syndrome?
Periodontitis.
Yes, it is seen in a younger age. First of all, age is young.
Palmar keratosis.
Yes, you will see the periodontitis, and you will also see palmar and plantar keratosis. So these are the findings you will see in papillon Lefevre syndrome. So in this also has been asked in exam, in which one image was there with a young child with periodontitis, and there were images shown of keratosis of palms and the foot. So in that case, the diagnosis can be given as papillon Lefevre syndrome. In case of advanced periodontitis or periodontal abscess also, you will see floating tooth appearance, or in the cherubism also there will be floating tooth appearance. Now, can anyone quickly tell me the appearance of eye in the cherubism?
Eye to heaven.
Yes, eyes rest to heaven. What is the reason for this?
Due to the expansion of both.
So this is our orbit, right? Below the orbit, this bone is there, the maxilla, the orbital extension of the maxilla and all. But in cherubism, what will happen? This part, if you see from the side, this, let's say this is orbit, which is eyes. Okay. These are the eyelids. And here the bone is there. But usually in this case, there will be expansion of this bone. So because there is expansion like this, usually when we see eyes, the below part of this pupil is not visible. But in this kind of cherubism, when this bone is expanding, this skin also will get stretched. And because skin gets stretched, this part will go below like this. So this, all this sclera below the eye also will be visible. So it will appear as if the person is looking up. Okay. That is why the normal eye where the pupil was like this, because of the expansion, it will become like this because more sclera started appearing below it. That's why it is known as eyes raised to heaven appearance. Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir.
So this is the floating tooth appearance you can see here. This is because of the gingival carcinoma. In the periodontal disease also, as it is visible here, it can lead to floating tooth appearance. Now talking about the types of root resorption. We can have different type of root resorption. The first type is knife edge root resorption, which is seen in ameloblastoma. So if this is tooth, and imagine it being cut by the knife. So in this case, only this appearance will be there, right? As if this part has been cut. So this type of resorption when we have, as you can see here, this kind of resorption is known as knife edge root resorption. And it is seen with the ameloblastoma. Second type is multiplanar, which is usually seen in CGCG. So if you, this is the root, the resorption can take place like this. So we can have like this appearance. This is known as multiplanar appearance, which is seen in CGCG, that is central Jansen granuloma, or we can have spike root resorption, which is seen in the chondrosarcoma. So if this is the root, a lesion will cause resorption like this. So we have a spike shaped root which is left. So it is known as spike shaped root resorption. And the cortical changes, we can have cortical expansion, which is intact and visible on the plain films or perforated. So as you can see here, this cortical expansion is there. Can you tell me what radiograph is this?
Lateral mandible.
Occlusion?
Yeah, occlusion. Lateral mandible, but it's occlusion. Lateral occlusal mandibular radiograph. So you can see this expansion taking place, which is clearly visible here. Right? This is an intact cortex. Then this is a cortical expansion, but you can see somewhat perforations are there. Okay, so we can have cortical expansion with perforation. This you can see in the malignant lesions also, or aggressive benign lesion like ameloblastoma, unicystic ameloblastoma. If it increases very much in size, it can also cause perforation. So what we can see in this lesion is the lesion which is here like this also, and it is also growing from this point. So it has caused displacement of this molar. You can see how far it has got displaced from the normal point. Okay, so the soft tissue mass must be like this. So this can be there, a cortical expansion with perforation, or cortical expansion with erosion without expansion, that is scalloping that I was talking about. So if this is the bone, and whenever there is erosion and scalloping taking place, this is known as scleroping, but it is not causing any kind of perforation here. Next is cortical erosion without expansion, that is saucerization. Now, can you tell me where do you see this saucerization, this kind of appearance?
Stephanocyst.
Stephanocyst, which is usually seen. If you see the relation between this inferior alveolar nerve and Stephanie bone cyst, what will be the relation?
Inferior. Below or above?
Yes, it will be below. Inferior to it. So, this depression of the salivary gland, when it is there on the mandible, it will appear like this. So it is causing the cortical erosion, but it is not causing any kind of expansion. It is also known as saucerization. You can also see this kind of appearance on the gingival cyst or even in the nasolabial cyst. When the cyst is in the soft tissue, but it is causing pressure on the bone. So it is causing erosion. That is also there. Or any neural tumors. Neural tumors also will cause this kind of lesions. So will do the peripheral giant cell granuloma. Now we can have different kind of reactions taking place on the periosteum. So this first is onion scale or layered appearance, which is seen in Garris osteomyelitis, the calcifying subperiosteal hematoma, Ewing sarcoma, the osteogenic sarcoma, Caffey's disease, metastatic neuroblastoma, or fractured cells. Now, how does this appearance take place?
Sir, Caffey's disease.
Hello.
Sir, what is Caffey's disease?
Caffey's disease. Who will tell what is Caffey's disease?
Neurofibromatosis. No.
Anyone?
Infantile hyper.
Correct. This Caffey disease, no? Its name itself is infantile hyperostosis. Okay, so what happens is there is presence of the cortex bone which is there within this if this is a bone, the
enostosis or exostosis?
Hyperostosis. Infantile cortical hyperostosis. So multiple layer of bone will be formed on the cortex. Okay, so that is why it is leading to this onion skin appearance. Now I'll tell you how does this onion skin appearance or the onion skin appearance actually take place. So let's say this is a bone.
Layer by layer.
Okay, and this is a lesion. Now when the lesion is of small size, it has not reached cortex only. No need to worry about that. Now once the lesion starts growing, our body will start to, or it will try to keep the cortex intact. So what it will do, because this bone is going to get displaced by this lesion now. So when it is getting displaced, the periosteum will also get displaced and it will deposit a layer of bone. So the lesion has reached here now. Now the lesion is going to grow even more. So when it grows even more, it will form another layer of bone. So surrounding the lesion, as it keeps on growing, it will keep on forming new layer of bones. So this kind of appearance is known as onion peel appearance or layered appearance. Then there is Codman's triangle. The Codman's triangle is the characteristic of
osteosarcoma.
Okay, so we have seen in the previous ones that the lesion, when it is growing normally, the periosteum will be raised and it will form new layered bone. That is the onion skin appearance. In the osteosarcoma, what happens whenever the lesion, let's say this lesion is growing like this, so it will cause raising of the periosteum like this on both the sides. So this raised periosteum on both the sides of the lesion. This is lesion. These are the triangles you will see on both the sides. These triangles are known as Codman's triangle. This actually we had discussed in detail when we were discussing osteosarcoma previously. And then we have sunburst appearance or sunray appearance, which is seen if you are talking about mandible, you can see in osteosarcoma, sarcoma, or hemangioma. Or when you want to see hair on an appearance, you can see in thalassemia, sickle cell anemia, or chronic iron deficiency anemia. This all are due to when the periosteum is raised, below the periosteum, the bone is formed perpendicular to the previous bone which was there. So if it is forming perpendicular, it will lead to this sunburst or sunray appearance or hair on head appearance. If it was forming parallel to it, it will lead to onion skin appearance that we are seeing in the CAFES disease, as I told you, and in the most common one that we remember is from osteomyelitis, that is known as
Gehry's osteomyelitis,
that is there in the hair, this onion peel appearance was there. Okay, so that's all from today. We have discussed the salivary gland imaging and the radiographic diagnosis. If you have any doubts, you can put on the exclusive group, or if you want.
Thank you.
Everyone, that's all for today. Agar koi bhi doubt hai, you guys can put on the group. We'll discuss on the group also. Yes. That's all for today.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Bye. Good night, everyone.
Good night, sir.
Thanks for watching the video. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel for more updates.